Welcome to Quick Literature Academy. Subscribe and press the bell icon for more literature videos. Tintern Abbey by William Wordsworth. Summary. The full title of this poem is Lines Composed a Few Miles Above Tintern Abbey. On revisiting the banks of the Wye during a tour, July 13, 1798, it opens with the speaker's declaration that 5 years have passed since he last visited this location, encountered its peaceful rural scenery, and heard the murmuring waters of the river. He recites the objects he sees again and describes their effect upon him. The steep and lofty cliffs impress upon him thoughts of more deep seclusion. He leans against the dark sycamore tree and looks at the cottage grounds and the orchard trees whose fruit is still unripe. He sees the wreaths of smoke rising up from the cottage chimneys between the trees and imagines that they might rise from vagrant dwellers in the houseless woods or from the cave of a hermit in the deep forest. Memory is important for sustaining the connection between man and nature. The subject of Tintern Abbey is memory, specifically childhood memories of communion with natural beauty. Both generally and specifically, this subject is hugely important in Wordsworth's work, reappearing in poems as late as the Intimations of Immortality ode. Tintern Abbey is the young Wordsworth's first great statement of his principle, great theme, that the memory of pure communion with nature in childhood works upon the mind even in adulthood, that is, when access to that pure communion has been lost, and that the maturity of mind present in adulthood offers compensation for the loss of that communion, specifically the ability to look on nature and hear human music, that is, to see nature with an eye towards its relationship to human life. In his youth, the poet says he was thoughtless in his unity with the woods and the river. Now, 5 years since his last viewing of the scene, he is no longer thoughtless, but acutely aware of everything the scene has to offer him. Additionally, the presence of his sister gives him a view of himself as he imagines himself to have been as a youth. Happily, he knows that this current experience will provide both of them with future memories, just as his past experience has provided him with the memories that flicker across his present sight as he travels in the woods. The speaker describes how his memory of beauteous forms has worked upon him in his absence from them. When he was alone or in crowded towns and cities, they provided him with sensations sweet, felt in blood, and felt along the heart. The memory of the woods and cottages offered tranquil restoration to his mind, and even affected him when he was not aware of their memory, influencing his deeds of kindness and he further credits the memory of the scene with offering him access to that mental and spiritual state in which the burden of the world is lightened, in which he becomes a living soul with a view into the life of things. The speaker then says that his belief that the memory of the woods has affected him so strongly may be vain, but if it is, he has still turned to the memory often in times of fretful stir, that is, a mixture feeling of worry and restlessness. Even in the present moment, the memory of his past experiences in these surroundings floats over his present view of them, and he feels bittersweet, touching joy in reviving them. He thinks happily, too, that his present experience will provide many happy memories for future years. The speaker acknowledges that he is different now from how he was in those long ago times when, as a boy, he bounded over the mountains and through the streams. In those days, he says, nature made up his whole world. Waterfalls, mountains, and woods gave shape to his passions, his appetites, and his love. That time is now past, he says, but he does not mourn it, for though he cannot resume his old relationship with nature, he has been amply rewarded by a new set of more mature gifts. For instance, he can now look on nature not as in the hour of thoughtless youth, but hearing oftentimes the still sad music of humanity. And he can now sense the presence of something far more subtle, powerful, and fundamental in the light of the setting suns, the ocean, the air itself, and even in the mind of man. This energy seems to him a motion and a spirit that impels all thinking thoughts and rolls through all things. For that reason, he says, he still loves nature, still loves mountains and pastures and woods, for they anchor his purest thoughts and guard the heart and soul of his moral being. Thanks for watching.